Welcome, everybody. All right. Welcome, one and all. We're doing a season ranking of Survivor.
Right? Yeah, every season. We are.
But here's the thing. If you're new to the channel and you just see ranking the seasons, it's a very specific set of seasons we're ranking here. And that's because I'm taking Alec through all the seasons chronologically for the first time. All right. And so far we got up, we just recently finished Micronesia. So there will only be 16 seasons included in this tier list. And essentially the way it's going to work moving forward, after we've established the tier list, is after each season, we'll open the tier list back up and we'll add the one season into the tier list wherever we think it'll go. And we're going to do the same thing with the winners. And so for the purpose of those, in the future, they'll all be combined into one video, all of our tier lists. So there'll be, like for next season, it'll be a video called Ranking Survivor Gabon. And we'll rank the cast, we'll add the season into the rankings, and we'll add the winner into the rankings. And that'll be one solid video. But since we've yet to establish the tier list, we're doing separate videos for those, so then we can get more into it.
Right.
And if you've been keeping up with the channel, we do season reviews after each season. And in those, we've been doing an ongoing ranking of the seasons. But it's gotten to the point where we've got so many seasons, so it's hard. We've just kept rattling them off, you know, like, here's my 15 seasons in order right now. And we've been saying it would make more sense to do a tier list because we can still have them ordered. They'll just be in tiers and it'll accomplish the same thing just with a nice, neater visual and not having to rattle them all off in that way. Everybody can see it on the screen. So, yeah, that's what we're here to do.
Okay.
And so we're going to each have our own tier list for this. So we both collaborated on ranking the cast, but since we've been having our separate rankings of the seasons and the winners, we wanted to keep that going with this. So we'll each have our own tier list, but we'll kind of each talk about the season, and then we'll both rank the same season, and we'll just keep going through them. Now, do we want to do the ranking in order of how they appear on this, which is alphabetical order, or do we want to go chronological order of the seasons? How do you want to do it?
I think let's go chronological. Let's shake it up a little bit here.
All right, so the fifth logo down here just says Survivor on it, but it's the original Survivor Borneo.
There it is, yes.
Where do you rank Survivor Borneo?
Survivor Borneo is like squarely in the middle. Like I'm putting it at C. Wow. I might move it around. I might maybe B. It's really good. It started it all. Maybe it should be in B. I'll stick it in B for now. We'll see how I'm feeling about that later.
So looking at my rankings before, we both have it at the fifth best season. Before Micronesia, we had a top five season. So
okay, so maybe it should be in A.
Yeah, but if you don't feel that way in your heart, your rankings don't reflect that so far.
Yeah, maybe not. Well, we'll see where we're at when we're.
But here's the thing: you look at these old school seasons. You got, they're obviously they're quite boring in comparison to where we're at now. Even just the 16 seasons. Yeah, it's like, and even specifically Borneo, you look back on it, is very much like almost a documentary style thing. It was more about okay, these people are on an island; they have to form a society together. It wasn't about the strategy of it. It was like a big deal that there was a four-person alliance in the season. And it's like the players on the season were like debating whether that's even okay, you know?
Right, like, yeah, that there's an alliance at all. Yeah, right.
The merged tribal council, there's like seven different... There's votes for like seven different people. It's like a crazy thing. It's just a mess. Yeah. And it's just kind of like... Yeah, Richard there is a strategic source, and he's kind of like... the mastermind of the season, but if you look at it on paper, there's like not much strategy there because the game hadn't really solidified yet. So it took a Richard Hatch to come in and make it what it was, with the help of a little alliance. Mm-hmm. But if you really look back, it's like the challenges are a little rougher.
I think we were commenting.
There's some scuffed ones in there. There's some fun. There's some charm to the scuffed nature to some of them, like the Rudy running around with like a video recorder. You, like they had to run around with a video recorder, like, answering questions. He's like, I don't know. I don't know. You know. You have him run into this like, house, this decrepit building looking for objects.
Oh, my God, and... yeah. And then someone got the wrong person's key, and then they automatically win, which is like, what? I remember being like, what do you mean? What does that mean?
And I remember even early on, we remarked on how they had trouble filming some of these challenges, really, like, making them look good.
Yeah, it was just like, man, like, they're just, like, running in the woods, and it's just, like, it looked horrible.
A sense of what's going on. It's like, oh, this tribe leading, and I'll take your word for it, I guess.
Right.
But okay. Well, you have to admire it for it being the first season.
Yeah.
And it's so cool in that way, I think, to look back on. One day I definitely would like us to do, like, a rewatch for the first four seasons, at least, because we've done reactions for all the other seasons. That would be kind of fun to look back on.
Mm. But, so where would you put this then?
I would say maybe B. I'll put it in B tier for now.
Okay. All right. Well, at least we're matched there. So. All right.
But it's one of those things. It's hard to rank that. Just like it's hard to rank Richard Hatch as a winner because you can't really. It's hard to compare anything. But.
Yeah.
Next up, we have the Australian Outback.
Yeah, now I have very... This is probably... I've had this historically quite high. Mm-hmm. I think I'm going to move it into A, because I still have very high... I still regard the season pretty highly, I think, overall.
From your rankings, you had it at number 3 out of all the seasons.
Yeah, it was super high. I think I'm going to... I'm putting it down a little bit. This is something that I've been kind of... It's been kind of cooking for a little bit in the noggin. I think I'm going to bring it down just a little bit. But I think it's still an amazing season. I think it kind of improved in every way to the first season. I think it even did its sort of maybe even the documentary style of thing, you know, concept. I think it did that like even better because I think that's the one thing that I always remarked about that I liked about it, is it really did feel like they were out there like it was like man versus nature. Like it really did feel like. Odds were stacked against them in a lot of ways out in the bush. So it was kind of fun to kind of see people come together in that way. I've always liked the season a lot. I think that the various bits of drama and stuff that happened in it are a lot of, you know, generally entertaining as well.
So you had it at number 3 previously. Yeah. I had it at number 9. I'm much lower on it.
Yeah.
So I think there's a buff and a debuff that goes into these old school seasons that we haven't, that aren't as fresh for us because we didn't do episode each week and we don't have them on the channel like that.
Right.
The buff is that you can kind of romanticize it. Mm-hmm. It could sound better in a blur. Yeah. And it was also, we binged those first few seasons as well.
Hardcore. Like we probably got through the entire first season, maybe like 4 sittings. Maybe it might have even been less.
So there's that, and then there's the debuff is we don't remember them as well as the newer ones, so it's hard to remember it as fondly or not as fondly. But I do remember the Australian Outback actually being pretty boring, a lot of it, and I feel like if we watched it week by week, especially now,
We would be we'd probably be bored. Yeah,
and
that's very
remember,
true.
I remember people really hating the finale because I think they went down to like a final 3. And then it was like a super long finale to get to like the final 2. I remember being people constantly trashing the finale, so I really want to rewatch that sometime.
That'd be fun. That might shake up Miss. I'd be like, "That's a D now. Mm-hmm. Get that out of here."
Because there's elements to it. Yeah, there's like the survival aspect of it, but that's obviously that's not my biggest draw for Survivor in general.
Well, that's the thing. I think that's what I remember liking about when Survivor was that way. I think that was something that I really enjoyed about that particular season. It's not something that would have been entertaining every year, and I'm kind of glad that the formula, more or less has got totally shaken up as the idea of the game sort of evolved. But.
I'm always partial to the more strategic seasons just because, like, Australian Outback, if you think of it, like, there's, like, a couple memorable moments. None of it's strategy-related, though. It's, like, Scoopin falls in the fire.
Yeah.
Kel has beef jerky? Question mark.
Yeah, jerky gate. Yeah.
Jerry
and Colby. Colby's
saying a lot of things, but I ain't no Hershey bar.
Yeah.
Colby.
I still don't know what that means.
There's Colby winning a bunch of challenges.
Yeah.
And then there's Colby taking Tina to the end and losing because of it.
Yep.
Oh, and there's Alicia pointing at Kimmy and saying, I will always wave my finger in your face.
I will always wave my finger in your face.
And Kimmy being upset that Mike Scoopin murdered a boar and other animal debates.
Yep.
But it's like none of that strategy. And then if you look at the trajectory of the season, once Scoopin leaves, it's all tipped in the one tribe's favor. And it just kind of is like a steamroll where Tina's side just takes out the other side. And then.
All right. Well, I'm moving down to C now.
Sorry.
No, I'm kidding. I'm going to keep it in A for now. I do think we legitimately need to rewatch it, though.
I would love to find a way to work that in to have a rewatch in there. The first four, so we at least have all the episodes represented on the channel,
right?
But
all right, so where do you get
some
this,
aspects
then?
Of it? Like, I would say C for now.
Okay.
One thing we'll love about a lot of these old school seasons is the environment, and it's a lot different. Like really cool locations that, like, you're gonna remember the Australian outback. You're gonna remember Africa versus like a bunch of island beach. Locations, right. You know.
Well, that's why China's so memorable, I think, in a lot of ways. We've obviously got a long way to go before we get there, but I think that was another thing that stood out about that season. So
next up, Survivor Africa.
Africa. So I know this is the one that it's weird because, like, well, it's not weird. I feel like I remember Africa and Marquesas the least by far. I think actually probably Marquesas is the one I remember the least. Africa is. I remember it for like the big shakeup moments. The game will change forever.
The game did change forever too when
they did
young Silas dirty and introduced the tribe swap because they're like tired of these young kids just mowing down the old people or whatever.
I mean, it was miserable. It was honestly miserable to watch.
It was miserable in the beginning, yeah.
So
they had to do it to them.
They had to. They really had to. So I guess that was the introduction of the mid-game shake-up,
yes,
you know, that we've seen many many times since,
and is a very cool location. From a lot of accounts, it seems to be like the hardest season to film in terms of like the conditions. From what I've heard, this one's often seen as like the top one or one of the top ones, like because
the heat or
it was brutal, like the heat. And I think they had to. This was a season where they had to trek over to get their water.
Trek
for it.
It's a big trek. Yeah.
And they were actually like surrounded by some dangerous animals. They had to have people like on standby to, and like don't pass this certain point or you'll die.
Were they in? Yeah. Were they in a wildlife preserve, like kind of area, or was it like a?
I don't remember.
Or was there? Or were they just like out in the Serengeti somewhere? I'm trying to remember exactly what the location was, but because like wildlife preserve, like nature preserves are enormous in Africa. So
it just says the season was filmed in Kenya, where the contestants had to put up with extreme heat conditions and dangerous wildlife because there were man-killing animals in the area. The tribes lived in thorny enclosures, as local tribe Kenyans do. That's all it says.
Okay. So yeah, so there are people doing hunts around them. That's kind of wild if that's
gnarly, but there's like I remember there was a cool shot, I forget, was it Frank that was someone was in a shot like they're doing confessional and you literally see like an elephant like come into the back of the frame.
That's right, yeah,
and that's the kind of cool stuff you don't get in these like later seasons that we're seeing, where you get a lot of nice b-roll but you don't see them actually right there.
You might have some some monkeys just hanging out in the trees up above, but that's about it. So, I remember the season overall being a little kind of eh for a lot, for like bits of it, but there's a lot of memorable stuff too. I'm going to put it firmly in, I think I have it pretty low on the list.
Yeah, I would say you have it. Yeah. This is out of 15. You have it 13th. Yeah. I have it a 14th.
So. Yeah, I'm putting it in D. I think this and Marquesas are the ones that I really have to, I think we really need to rewatch the most.
Yeah, it's like, I don't even know if it's bad. It's bad. Yeah. That it should be,
I don't even
D,
know if it's bad. Yeah.
Because I'm tempted to say C, but yeah. I will say this has some iconic characters, and we have
Big Tom.
Lex, we have Big Tom, and Ethan is one of like the most likable winners. Like everybody loves Ethan. He's just like a nice guy. He had a nice moment in, with like the where he went. They went to the little village, and he was like playing hacky sack and playing soccer.
Oh yeah, that was such, yeah. I remember. I remember being like really like moved by that. That was like a cool moment. And I for some reason you even reminded me of this during All Stars. It was like, yeah, you just hated Lex, and I was like, I don't remember this at all. I was like, I have no. Why did I not like him? It was so bizarre.
Cracked that case.
Yeah, and there was a whole figure that out.
A fun sequence towards the end where T-Bird puts a vote on Lex, and then like lies about it, and Lex is like going crazy, like who voted for me? Who the hell voted for me?
Yeah, it was the before.
And that's basically where like I think Kelly gets framed for it essentially, and gets voted out. Because he thinks that she voted for him, and T-Bird did some like sneaky hiding it. But yeah, it's tough.
Yeah, well, that's one of the benefits here, that this is a fluid system. You know, season to season we can change this around as much as we want.
Yeah, but. I'll give it a D. Though I will say, like, as far as Survivor goes, in these first 16 seasons, I'm like hard pressed to say any of them are bad, you know?
Yeah.
Like, well, everything up from Africa, like in my rankings, I had like Guatemala, Palau, Fiji. Yeah. Actually, I wouldn't say any of them are bad necessarily, but
right.
Just not some as just good as others.
Yeah, some of them are just not as interesting that way. Yeah.
Next up, we have Survivor Marquesas.
Yeah.
Which saw Vesepia beat Nalia in the end. And so, previously, you had Marquesas at number 9?
I think I'm putting this squarely in C, and that's almost because I just don't really remember it all that particularly well. I remember Boston Rob, the pre-jury gem of pre-jury gems.
Sadly, he made the merge and it was like the one right before the jury.
Yeah.
He had the iconic straight out of the Godfather. You rule by fear.
Yeah. Straight out of the Godfather. Yeah.
It's like, okay, Buster Rhymes, let's see you come back and throw All Stars and do something like that.
And he did.
And he did. then we had the fun dynamic with, like, Sean. Sean and Rob had a fun dynamic. There was a Sean Pascal.
Yeah.
Sean and Vesepi had a nice relationship.
Sean in general was just like, fun. Is it a great Survivor player? Yeah. For sure.
And you had Nalia. I remember Vesepia versus Nalia in the end. I remember Nalia saying, like, I didn't start playing this game until, like, day 35 or something.
I'm like, wow, that's a really good way to state your case.
I didn't really start playing. But the iconic things from the season are there. There was the big moment that everyone remembers from the season is when they did the flip on the power structure when they first had that challenge where you had to chop other people's things. And you saw the whole power structure. Everybody was like that got eliminated was in order of like how they were seen in the game. And everybody looked around and they're like, all right, we need to do something about this, and they basically overturned the power structure. And that was a big moment.
Right, the flipping, the flip.
And that was fun. And then we also had the whole, there was a tie at the final four?
I think it's final
five.
Final four had a tie, I think.
Where it was Pascal drew the purple rock. It was the first time he did the purple rock tiebreaker. and he got taken out there.
Yeah.
And then we also had Kathy that season, who was a fun character.
Oh, yeah.
Primed to maybe win if she made it to the end and didn't quite make it there.
Right.
But I do really like Marquesas. They also had the fun Boston Rob kind of one of his bigger moments early on where he took out Hunter, and then Hunter was like, I hope you all die or whatever.
Right. Right. And he's a guy with like the tack light thing, right? He's like a spokesman for like some like flashlight company.
I forget what it was. Was it a flashlight company?
Yeah. Something like that. Yeah.
But yeah, there's some fun stuff in here. I think if we rewatched it, we'd be kinder to it.
Yeah, I think I'd be much higher on my list, I think, but I just don't. I honestly just don't really remember it.
You had it at 9, I have it at number 8. I just kind of have a problem bringing it too high.
Yeah.
Though I kind of, like, I have Borneo higher, that I kind of would rather watch some Marquesas if on any given day. It's just kind of the Borneo gets that natural buff.
Mm-hmm.
But I think I will put Marquesas in the B tier.
Okay. Put it right there.
Where do I put it? Should I put it above Borneo? I'll put it above Borneo.
Okay. Do it. Fair enough.
So we're gonna have some shakeups in our rankings here.
Yeah, I think we are as we're going through it and tier listing it.
So where do you put Marquesas?
Oh, I put Marquesas in C. You put squarely in C, and it's only like literally because I just don't remember it all that well.
Okay.
And
you're ranking them within your tiers, right? I can't remember your list. Yep. All right. So next up, Survivor Thailand. This is the first season we did episode by episode reactions for on the channel.
Talked it was.
About every episode and did a review as well.
Yep.
It's an F.
It's an F. Easy F. I don't even think we need to go into why.
It's like I put Thailand when we did our ranking, everything reviewed on the channel.
Yeah.
We ultimately ended up with it in the D tier because it's like Survivor is still
it's mostly still
good.
Yeah.
But when you compare it to other Survivor seasons, you got to put it at the bottom. It's one of the worst seasons we've ever seen. It's literally the worst so far, at least.
Yeah, it's pretty bad. It's going to be tough to... I mean, it's really going to have to take a really uninteresting season and then also just like off-putting stuff happening to make it lower. Because like the thing is like... One we got coming up had some off-putting stuff happen during it, but
it's definitely much better because
it's much better, much better.
This one had off-putting stuff, but also just did not have much going on and not the most interesting cast. I think the best episode of the show of the season is the finale because you have some fun. Like there's a fun final tribal council where they both get raked over the coals.
Yeah,
and there's a fun final challenge where they have the coins. And they're like in the sweaty cave.
Oh, yeah. That was fun. Yeah.
The fun stuff there.
Yeah.
But I remember it's like the game. We titled the episode, like episode 13. It was like the game begins.
The game begins.
Literally, because there are a lot of seasons we've seen where they do a pagonging of sorts where they take out a whole tribe without any shakeups. Mm-hmm. But this one somehow did it in an even more uninteresting way, where it was like there was no drama on each vote. It's like I couldn't even see them voting out someone else. It was just like, oh, it's definitely going to be this person or one of these people on the opposite tribe. And then like there was barely any drama between the group as a result. So it was like, ooh, once we get down to these five people on the tribe or whatever, then we'll get something going. And we got... A little bit, but it was like, you know, Brian ran a clinic out there, and he was Mr. Freeze.
Mr. Freeze, Brian. Yeah. I just love that. It's an F. It's an F. It's just an easy F. Yeah, it's pretty pretty cursed season of Survivor, that's for sure.
Yeah.
Still some enjoyment to be had in there, bits and pieces.
It's hard every once in a while. I think of moments, though. It's like it was kind of some fun with Rob as a back nick, Rob with two B's being like a...
Oh, be like killing Clay or the redemption of Rob's...
Yeah, he's strangling Clay. He has a little redemption arc. He had his feud with Sheehan.
Yeah.
Then they did Sheehan with the fake merger. I didn't say anything about a merge.
Yeah.
Yeah. And she was like the one person you could root for in that season.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, because she is like her against all these miserable, horrible people. And it was like, oh, and then she gets voted out immediately.
Yep, right before the jury, too.
Yep.
All right, next up is Survivor of the Amazon.
Yep.
It's a great season. It's one of the
first season
where you see some like breakout strategy really coming in, like a real strategist, more so than these other seasons so far.
Yeah.
Where you see, like, Rob Cesternino is the star of the show.
Definitely.
He's running things the whole game, and it's fun to see him maneuver. You have the dramatic flip where you have, there's, like, the Jenna, Heidi, Alex click where they're just, like, laying around. They're like, we're chilling. We're good. We don't have to do anything. And then Alex was dumb and said that we'll go to the final four, but then we'll just duke it out. Like, you wanted to just duke it out at the final four. I wasn't even going to vote with them, guaranteed.
Right.
So he's like, well, I'll take you out now then, because I don't like that for me.
Yeah.
And you have some fun stuff. There's the Battle of the Sexes.
Yeah, Battle of the Sexes as a concept was just
kind of
like,
toxic in there a little bit.
Kind of toxic, but like I it was in a way that like I don't know. I guess I was in the right mood for it at the time. I really like the season a lot. I think it's one of my favorites. It's like it's just out of S right now. We'll see how it shakes up, but like this is probably going to end up in S, I think.
You hit it at number 2 out of the first 15. Yeah. Actually, I had for the longest time very high, but it's kind of gone down a little bit for me. It went down to number 6, though I don't necessarily agree.
I'm sticking it in S. I actually have a clean list now at the moment, so I'll put an S for now. We'll see how I'm feeling in a bit, but it's one of my favorites.
I don't agree with myself in my rankings that I had it below the Borneo. I would definitely have it above that. I'll put it in A tier for me for now.
Okay.
But I think it's really solid as far as these old school seasons go, where there's still minimal strategy, but it helps a lot. Rob Cesternino's there and makes these fun moves, and you have like Christy being in the middle, and then she's like refusing to give Rob a definitive answer. So it was like, well, Jenna, Heidi, why don't we just vote Christy out and save herself the trouble?
Yeah,
and then the only thing that constantly really brings the season down for me is how it ends.
The ending is pretty bad. It's pretty disappointing ending. It's like the best shonen anime. You know, they have a really great, just an amazing premise, a fantastic, and then it just completely falls flat when it tries to end. It's really unfortunate, but you still have the memories of all the good times that you had during the episodes. So.
Because, as much as, like, there's some excellent seasons that have horrible endings, and it's, like, there's still excellent
seasons. This is, like, chief among them, I think. this is right up there as one of the most disappointing endings of a Survivor season.
But I'm definitely going to hold it against you. Yeah. Like, if there's an excellent season that has an excellent ending, that's going to ascend over it. And we've had a couple of those, but... It's just tough when it's like he ran the game all the way to the end and Jenna just votes him out because it's the obvious thing to do. And you have Jenna versus Matthew, so there's not even any drama with that vote. It's like two people are like, it's like, whatever.
Yeah.
And then Jenna was literally someone who wanted to quit at one point and was like, it's hard to root for her too much. But
she still won.
She won.
Up against all odds.
And she did... Jen and Heidi took off their clothes for peanut butter and chocolate.
They didn't even have to.
Didn't have to.
They straight up didn't have to. He was offering it to them anyway.
Yeah. Put icons, put them on Playboy, and we'll call it a day.
Yep.
Yeah. So A for me, S for you.
I think I'm going to bump it down to A as well. Talking about, because like the ending really does kind of suck some of the joy out of it. It's an S season up until that ending, really, for real.
Because you take, if you get Rob in the end and he loses, I still would say that's excellent, because he's like, there's still like a storyline there. It's just so sad. Like this season, the next season kind of too, is like you want to see that person get there just to see how the jury will react to them.
Mm.
And you don't get that. It's like, oh, you're right there. How, like, if the jury was going to be bitter against them, so be it. At least we'll like to see it.
Yeah.
But it seems like he probably would have won, which would have been very satisfying from like start to finish from the game.
Yeah.
But it shows you how important those challenges are at the end. Where
big time.
He's literally just standing, balancing on a thing, like holding the thing on his head, and that's all it came down to.
Mm-hmm.
Next up, we have Survivor Pearl Islands.
Yeah.
It's an easy S.
It's an easy S tier. Easy S tier. This is one where, like, even the fact that I just picked up the wrong thing. I can't read. All right, Pearl Islands, easy S for both of us. Yeah, I think theming, pinpoint perfect. Like, we've only up until recently seen a better, like, themes done as like quite so well. I think China is the only one that quite rivals it in terms of how they nailed the theming of the whole season.
Mm-hmm.
The twists were fun. Rupert, I mean, is just an all-time icon of Survivor. But Johnny Fairplay as well, as the wonderful heel of the season.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I mean, it's just fun from start to finish. I think it's easy to agree that like it maybe isn't the most satisfying ending of all time, but it's certainly not like it's not upendingly kind of disappointing like Amazon is. It's just kind of like, okay, well, it didn't quite finish as strong as it was kind of in the mid game, but
like it was a fun finale for sure. We both love Sandra. Sandra's great, but obviously it would have been nice to see Johnny Fairplay there just to see how people would have reacted to him, to see him actually make it there.
Mm.
It would have been more interesting, certainly, than like a Sandra versus Lil, where it's like, okay, well,
it's just like, well, I think we know how this is
going to go, and Lil had no chance going in there.
None.
The one of the bigger negatives of the season is the whole Outcast twist.
Yeah.
Not necessarily the most fair twist.
No.
And though it does luck out in that we do get two people who are in the end game. You get Burton and Lil, who have like a huge impact on the rest of the season, so that's cool.
Yeah.
But don't necessarily agree with the twist.
Yeah, your past comes back to haunt you.
There's just so many iconic moments in the season. There's so many, even very early on, like episode 2, I think, is the one where Sandra and Johnny Fairplay are yelling at each other.
Yeah, I can get loud too.
What the fuck?
Yeah, it's super loud. Yeah.
Sandra has great one-liners and confessional. It was like, he's an ass.
He's an ass. Yeah. Well, I also think it's one of the best first episodes of Survivor. I think it's only really rivaled. Still, I think is only really rivaled by like Cook Islands as a best first episode. I think it was perfect. It was perfect.
Definitely. It's so cool. They've never done anything like it in any of these other seasons where you go to this whole market negotiating for stuff.
Yeah.
Give me my money back.
It was just a lot of fun. Yeah, give me my money back. There's that. And I'm like,
Sandra.
Where did you? It's like, where did you get these? Pirated.
And then you look back on that retrospect too. It's like, wow, the two of the most iconic people from this season too interacting
right there.
And Rupert is a breakout star. I mean, he takes the whole season is like defined by him. He's the main character up until his like dramatic Shakespearean tragedy-esque end.
Yeah, seriously, that whole episode was like, I think that was like my first like a Survivor star episode, because I was like, they just are, there was such an artful arc that they, his send off is just like, they did such a good job that
it's
the
beautiful.
edit of that was so good.
And there's beautiful
Yeah.
stuff in there. Some of this right stuff, like, it writes itself, like Johnny Fairplay at a confessional, where he's like, where he's basically saying, I know Sandra's not gonna win. Like, I got $1 million. She ain't gonna be number one. You know, this is, she
Yeah.
ain't gonna be number one.
Right.
And then you cut to the end, you see how it goes.
Yeah. It's, you've got that, you've got, I mean, the dead grandma
Dead grandma
boy.
moment.
Yeah.
Constant feuding, and it's like one of those rare things where you have like Sandra and Johnny Fairplay are going at it the whole season, and somehow are like together in the final three. You know, like these bitter rivals. Lil just being her mopey self, being
Lil
surprisingly
just,
impactful in the season, but.
yeah,
And then you have like the Johnny
the suffering.
Fairplay and Burton being like so cocky. They go on this reward and they're like, we got these girls like wrapped around our finger basically, and they outmaneuver them while they're out there. I was like, well, let's just vote one of them out. They vote Burton out.
You know, John, he's a snake, he lies, but you know, he
He
tells the truth
tells the truth
sometimes
sometimes
too.
too. He tells the truth too. Dara, a star as
Yeah.
well. Yeah. So,
In
there's
some
some great
people's mind,
stuff.
I'm
I
sure.
mean, like, even the pre-merge is one of the better, more exciting pre-merges. Like, there's all these feuds. There's like, Burton was actually the one who said they should throw the challenge to, I think, get Rupert out or something.
Yeah.
And he ends up getting blindsided. They vote him out instead, only for him to come back later. We had the whole Produce Ryan, which in itself wasn't very interesting, but we made
No.
something out of it. So.
We had fun with it, 'cause it was just like Ryan, produce clerk, and then just like every shot of him is just like twitchy Ryan over there.
Well, Andrew Savage just say like, what did
Yeah.
he's forget the quote now. Wet noodle. He was like wet noodle.
He's a wet noodle.
I had it on one of our Tarkon Hangman we did, was the whole
Yeah.
quote.
Yeah. He's a
Skinny
wet
wet
noodle.
noodle.
Yeah. You call him like a, you skinny limp dick fuck.
Skinny limp dick produce fuck. It's like the energy he was given.
Yeah,
If he were to say it
for
today, it would have
real.
been that.
It's just
Something
like,
like
it was
that.
like, for crying out loud. Die, jerks. You know?
But Pearl Islands for the longest time has been our
Yeah.
favorite season and hasn't budged.
Yeah.
We'll see when
Yeah.
we get to 16. That's the only one that's a question about right now, so.
Yeah. Yeah.
But next up we got Survivor All Stars.
Okay. Yeah. So, this is kind of in the same sort of position as like, same position in a way as Thailand, is it being kind of like, at least in the first few episodes of it having a lot of cursed energy. But it turns up being a way more interesting season by the end. It's still not like, it's not the most exciting winner of all time, but there's a lot of fun, like it literally feels like The Godfather or like The Sopranos, where it's like the
Well,
man and his wife controlling the game,
this is,
you know. And it's like,
I'd say it's more interesting pre-merge actually,
really?
and it really takes a dive after the merge, because you know you have all your big characters, all the people we want to see as Survivor All Stars are there pre-merge, they all get taken out, and then we're left with the scraps, who bow their head and let Boston Rob steamroll his way to the end.
Okay, that's okay, fair enough. In terms of actual strategy, I think you're actually right, if we're being
Because they really
honest.
were stuck with
But
Alicia, Jenna
yeah.
Lewis, and then even Amber herself, who
Yeah.
were like there, they probably shouldn't have been there to begin with, and it's
You have
rough.
Big
That's why
Tom and
it's like one of the most cursed
yeah.
boot orders ever, where it's like
Yeah.
all your fan favorites are getting taken out early, and
Yep.
then we're left with who's left, and then there's like no one like does anything to oppose Rob and Amber
Right.
when they should, and all these moments where they should, but ultimately it's like almost a pagonging, except for Shein wins immunity once, and they take out Alicia, but then I mean, Rob really positions himself with some real, like, winners of strategy. He's got Rupert and Big Tom and Jenna Lewis there at the end with him. So he's just like, it's a cakewalk for him.
Pretty much, yeah.
And it's just unfortunate that, you know, the bigger all-stars, the nature of the season is like, with having these weaker players in the mix, they're naturally going to band together and you're going to take out Richard Hatch early on, Rob's sister Nino. And then we had Jenna Maraska had to leave. Just
leaving first thing. That was like the first thing, wasn't it?
No, that was episode three.
Episode three? Okay, yeah.
And
it was kind of early on, but then Rudy, it was like.
Well, we had Tina voted out first because she's a winner.
Yeah, and she's the winner. Boom. We can't have her. We can't have winners.
Yeah, so no all winners. The winners toast. Yeah. Jenna quits. Tina's out. Yeah. Ethan gets taken out. Richard gets taken out.
Yeah.
Got
no winners, and then Sue.
Sue the Hawk. Whole Sue.
Yeah, the whole Sue Hatch fun. The Hedgehog incident. Yeah, it was not good. That's more what I'm thinking of. I'm thinking of, like, we're getting rid of all the winners.
Yeah.
It's kind of miserable conditions. We're focusing on, like, not the most interesting people. And, like, and then, like, that happens. And Jenna Maraska leaves. And it's just, like, what is going on with this season right now? Like, that was why it was, like, it's interesting in the sense that it's, like, you don't know what the hell is happening. But it's also, like, cursed. And not interesting, because you're like, why is Survivor falling apart in front of my eyes?
Mm-hmm.
It's not interesting strategically, but it's more interesting because a love story happens on Survivor. Like, well, that's ultimately why that season, to me, the second half of the season is interesting, because it's not really like a game of Survivor anymore. It's like, it's something completely different.
I really like
that. That's why I find that interesting, I think.
When I think of the finer parts of All Stars, I think of, like, just the moment of, like, everyone being there together in the beginning. It's like, wow, these are...
Yeah.
It's what a moment, this All Star season. And then it is kind of like a storybook ending, but also I like the heaviness of it that a lot of people don't like about the season, where in the final tribal, where it's just, like, brutal. Like, some of the most brutal...
Speeches
against Rob and stuff.
I love that too. I actually thought that was really great, because it was like, it was clear who was gonna win, kind of when you see that, which is wild. Oh, but really wild.
It wasn't. It was 4-3 vote. It was dramatic. And what is
very dramatic.
It was cool to see. Like, and it was like probably of any of the seasons we've watched so far, the only example I can think of is a straight up, like, we voted for this person despite the other person, essentially.
Mm.
So, but of course, you know, I don't think Rob's staying up at night thinking about it, since he's literally married to the winner. But
yeah, it's very true. It's very true.
But it's like the only little thing they could get in there was like a little like F you at the end. They were just going to give the girl that you took with you the win. But,
okay. Well, I'm going to put this, I think, in C under Marquesas.
Okay. So previously, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You had number 11, I had number 10. Out of 15, the first 15. Yeah, it's somewhere, it's either C or D for me.
Yeah.
In terms of Survivor seasons. I'll put it in C behind Australian Outback for now.
Okay.
That's what I'll do. Survivor Vanuatu.
Vanuatu.
I love Survivor Vanuatu, and it's kind of underrated in a sense, but people do point to the pre-merge being pretty boring in some ways, because there's some boring people in there, like the Brooks, the John P's, the John K's of the world.
John P, together. John K.
But the refreshing part of that is that we didn't get these young athletic people steamrolling, and we got the actual older people.
Yeah, that I like that a lot. It did become way more interesting post-merge. We also got to see Rory.
Yeah, Rory is a standout.
Is a standout.
You go from, like, being graded by him to, like, I'm here for him. I'm here for the energy.
Yeah, he brings.
And yeah, it's a shame that he kind of gets cut short right before the jury when he could the merge. But it's refreshing in the sense that yeah, the pre-merge just kind of suffers for it. But at least we got the pretty much all the most boring people are taken out pre-merge, and we're actually left with the more interesting people.
Yeah.
Left to have an impact.
Yeah, and it just ended up being just a genuinely kind of fun season, and like right up to the very end.
Yep, and the storyline with Chris being the last man standing,
mm-hmm.
and he's literally, his wife is there with the immunity challenge, and they lose it, and he's like, "I'm going home tonight. I'm going home, honey."
Yeah,
it's like losing his voice. And then after the fact in the reunion, he said he like kept up that lie. When he went home, he said, "I did get voted off that night," and up until the finale.
That's
and then
this is like top of B for me, if not in A. It's a really good season of the show. I agree. I think I had it kind of lower, but honestly, this is a really great season of the show. I think
there's a lot of fun scheming, and the whole like when they blindside Leanne, because it was like basically them revolting against Amy and her, like they're so comfortable and confident.
Yeah, Ice Queen Amy. This is where she had her reign.
Come up in there.
But
we get the odd ducks kind of band together, like Chris, Eliza, Twyla, and Scout band together to make this happen. And like some of these people have like Eliza, Twyla, and Scout are all like beefing constantly, you know.
I'm now thinking of one of my favorite Survivor moments, which is Sarge, who's just sitting there and having to listen to Scout just singing.
Mm-hmm. But he hates him because he had just tweeted out. Yeah. Probably Chad at that point. Remember Chad? Yeah. But
Chad wasn't bringing the Chad energy. He was not.
But it was a fun story to where you have these fun strategic moments where like Twyla's like, you know, the one person, she's telling Chris, you know, the one person you could talk to change this whole game around.
Mm.
And he's like, Scout? You? I know. He's like, Twyla. That's right. That's right. And then he makes it happen. It's like, was a nice little maneuver where she's like, she doesn't have a good enough relationship with Eliza to make it happen, but she knows if he talks to her, they can make it happen. They turn the whole game around. And then Chris has got some fun confessionals where he's just like, I don't even have to do anything, you know? And like they're taking each other out, you know?
Yeah. And he somehow manages to, against all odds, he somehow manages to win.
But then he gets more and more like evil as the into the finale and stuff. Where he's like, he does not give a damn. He's like lying to Eliza for no reason when he votes to Julia, and he's just like,
lying for no reason. You might as well at this point. It's a really good season of the show.
Chris is great. He's got a great final tribal. It's awesome. It's an A for me. And in fact, it's probably the top of A for me.
Yeah.
Right now.
It's reasonable. Yeah.
Previously, you had it at number 4. I had it at number 2 out of 15.
I had it at number 4. I'm putting, you know what? Screw it. Well, I'm actually going to put
trust yourself now. It doesn't matter what you had then.
It's true.
How do you feel?
Well, okay. Well, I'm looking here. I have what? Pearlands, Amazon, Outback. I would put it above Outback. It is that good of a season, I think. Yeah. I put it below Amazon. I'm still here for the Amazon, the sexy vibes of Amazon, but
it's great. Maybe I have rose-tinted glasses, and that like maybe the pre-merge is worse than I remember, because everything I talk about is post-merge. But
it is pretty rough. But like Rory's there to help us through it.
Yeah,
you know,
Rory's so awesome.
We grow with Rory. So.
And I will say more times than not, if I'm going to have a part of the Survivor season be rough, I want it to be the pre-merge and have a really interesting post-merge, you know, that I'm more likely to overlook a bad pre-merge than a bad post-merge where it's just like a rough
end. It's like almost expected to have that tutor, because it's like, you know, when you're editing a show, it's like you're not gonna, like, how many interesting things can you have?
You're not as invested these people that are even voted out early on, and sometimes they're just some less interesting people. They're not as good players, and yeah. Next up, we got Survivor Palau. The winner, Tom.
Tom is the man among men.
He's a man among men. I mean, Tom is such a unit. He's a powerhouse this season.
Ian is his son, basically his surrogate son.
The biggest storyline this season is, of course, the decimation of the Oolong tribe. Bobby John and Stephanie, the last two left. They do the fire making, which leaves Stephanie as the lone person, and then there's no real merge. It's just Stephanie goes over to the tribe.
Yeah,
the other tribe, which you've never done before. And so people point to that as being a really good, like, interesting part of the season. I have some problems with, like, ultimately it's not as interesting to me to have, like, any of the strategizing on that tribe be pretty pointless. The fact where it's all decimated anyway.
Right. I think we sort of talked about it, like, all right, well, now time for the game to start. Like, when it was just like, oh, and now
but it's like, and then it's after all that, Stephanie's, of course, the hero of the season, because, like, all these tribal councils, she's been to all of them, pretty much.
Yeah.
And you're so invested in her surviving all this, but then, like, Greg with 2 G's comes in, and he's,
like... 3G Greg.
And he's basically like, yeah, no, I don't want that storyline in here. I mean, the storyline's too good, like, she'll easily win. And it's like, yeah.
Right.
And you guys have a whole tribe still, so you're obviously, she has no chance.
Yeah.
So you survive this whole journey of her surviving this and, like, scrapping by.
So we need to crush her spirit. We need to screw the TV.
Yeah, there's no way you let her get to the end in any or anywhere close to the end, because the story writes itself. So that's why most of the more interesting seasons to me are the ones that come in relatively even tribes in the merge. But it's obviously very unique in that way.
It was like, we had, like, you know, it was like Ian, Katie, and blah, blah, blah.
Ian, Katie, drama of it all, and he's begging on his knees. And
that was some good, like, you felt that, you know? It's like, I think we were both like, yeah, we've been there before. Like,
but it's such an interesting angle that we didn't, probably wouldn't expect to see from Ian, is that, like, he literally lays down his, after the longest immunity challenge ever, like, 13 hours in, he's like, you know what, thought about it, and I think Katie or Tom should take Katie to the end, and that's it.
Yeah.
Okay. Right. Tom's like, you know,
13 hours is a long time to think.
I respect your wishes, and
I don't know if they really like, I don't know how well they really thought through that immunity. There's another one coming up here too. There's some final immunity challenges that I call bullshit on. That one was,
people loved it.
Well, that one was psychotic. People love that one.
Yeah, we love the endurance ones where you can just go, like,
I like endurance ones, but, like, it seemed like it was too easy. It's when they basically willpower, had to though. Call it at that point.
Yeah.
I don't know, man.
He called it himself. Ian called it.
Yeah, Ian called it.
He lost the will, like, to freaking win the game, literally, in the of course, that challenge. If Tom dropped 10 hours in, he would have been, all right, I'll just go to the end.
Yeah, I don't know. It was always, that one was always pretty lame to me, to be perfectly honest. I get why you would think that it's cool, but, like, I don't know. It wasn't as exciting to me as all that.
Wow.
The next one, the water polo one, wherever the hell, not water polo, it's the one where you had to balance on the buoyancy of water. That one was nonsense. That one was actually garbage. So, like, actual trash.
You mean the Panama one?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Palau, kind of lower. I think I don't remember where I had that one.
You had Palau
relatively high. Yeah, in the middle.
So you're still off base with your own ranks. You might as well just do it, because you're way off. You had a number 14 out of 15, so you didn't have it relatively high at all.
Yeah, I guess not. I don't know.
I had it 12 out of 15.
I guess we'll throw it in D. We'll throw it in D, above okay. Africa.
Okay. I think this is a C. I think this is a C, and it's Put it at the top of C. I'm gonna put it at the top of C, actually.
That's controversial. I don't know about that.
I don't think so.
Top of C.
There are people that look upon this people very really fondly, love this actually.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we're kind of the outliers, but.
Yeah, I might give it bottom of C. It's just under All Stars. It does have some good stuff. I mean, I think we Tom, the competitor that he is, you know. That was fun. I mean, that was seeing that the last half of the show is interesting. Just seeing one person dominate an entire game is kind of enjoyable in its own weird way.
Yeah, a lot of times
that and Stephanie is just like a really entertaining personality.
Ingenue,
yeah.
But yeah, a lot of the times these more dominant winners make for less interesting seasons as a result, because it's like, you know, usually it's just they keep it locked down so much that there's not much interesting happening. Yeah. But I also like to see like some like great game on display like that too. So yeah, I always have a fondness for these dominant performances as well. This is impressive. Next up we have Survivor Guatemala. Okay. Or Danny Boatwright wins against Stephanie, the very aforementioned Stephanie. And previously you had it ranked number 10. I had it at number 13.
This is the one that's going in D, I think, above Africa. Okay.
Guatemala is a few steps above Palau. I have it just one notch below Palau, but I always see it as like the little sequel to Palau.
It's kind of a two-parter. I don't know. There's parts of now that I'm looking at. I don't know. There's parts of it that is not that we're going. You know, some of these things blend together in my brain. There's a lot of this season though. This was a fun one in terms of where it was shot too, though. I will say that.
It's such a
that made it kind cool of interesting. Location. Such a cool location.
They did a really good job. One of the only locations where you can say, "I hope you get bitten by freaking crocodiles."
Yeah.
Scumbags.
Freaking scumbags. Yeah.
Judd's awesome. He made for some chaos in the pre-merge, and he had some the tribal council where he's standing up and he's like, ADD. Yeah. He said, I have ADD. And yeah, it's a cool location.
I'm a sportsmanship. I have, I'm not a bad sportsmanship. I've never been a bad sportsmanship.
Yeah, that's like a Trumpism, isn't it?
Yeah, it does feel like a Trumpism. It really does.
So you remember the premiere of that season? They started with the infamous 11-mile trek where everybody's dying.
Who could forget? Brutal. So that brutal. Entertaining, and it's a brutal season. It's like it took them like a week to recover from that, like a literal week. Like they were dying for like the first few episodes.
And a couple of the first boats are just like, this person's dying more than us.
This person is like vomiting everywhere.
Old Jim broke his arm and he's dying.
Jim broke his arm. Bobby John looked like he was contracting a demon.
And then we got Touch My Leg. Bobby John versus Jamie.
Now, you know what? Screw this. I forgot how much I liked this season, actually. Now that we're going through the moments. I'm going to put it right above Palau again. It's a more interesting season.
Yeah, I feel like it might be above Palau, too. It's tough.
Yeah. It's a more interesting season in a lot of ways, but
I've always had Palau at the narrowest above, like literally had it right above it, like because they're like hand in hand for me. But
yeah.
good stuff, because I do like a lot of the fun chaos, the characters of it, and the whole arc from Jamie and Bobby John going from rivals to pure sexual tension on the jury.
Yeah.
And
I the love jury to see is.
It. Well, they wanted to kiss. You could tell they wanted to kiss when they're button heads. You know, like
yeah,
that
they're
too.
Like,
would have
yeah,
been such like, a oh. television moment.
Yeah, it would have
too
been
too hot for
would have
TV,
been like,
though.
Wow. Yeah.
They wouldn't have
hey,
shown
enemies.
It.
Enemies to Lovers is like one of my favorite tropes.
And we
so,
got it
100% go.
Confirmed in the season.
I know.
That's definitely what it was. You had the Cindy Carr decision.
Mm-hmm.
Do I give everybody cars where I keep my car?
Yeah.
You have Rafe, who's really fun.
Rafe, oh yeah. All the Rafe moments.
Blows
Rafe
it at
is
the end.
One of, yeah, blows it at the end, but it's. He's one of my favorites of Survivor, just in general.
Stephanie, kind of from like a hero to a villain arc here.
Yeah, does kind of have a little bit of a turn, which is also entertaining to see too. But
mm-hmm. got Lydia doing her pancake dance. I mean, it's just never ending.
It after it, man.
Danny, we didn't even talk about Danny because she didn't just go under the radar. She beat the radar, baby, and that's what she says.
That's the stupidest thing I've ever heard. Where are you putting this?
Let's see. Do I put it above or below Palau?
Also, just Gary Hogaboom. Just in general. I like Gary a lot.
Gary Hawkins. Yeah. I'm going to go back to Gary Hawkins in Indiana and beat you down.
Mm-hmm.
So... Oh, and there was, and there was Blake talking about how his girlfriend's boobs are too big. It's just iconic moment after iconic moment. The pool party for Danny's birthday, where
party,
the tribe
yeah.
like came over to the other tribe.
Yeah, that was like one of the first times that's really ever happened in Survivor.
Mm-hmm. So the only thing that is kind of holding me up is that, you know, doesn't have to have a great ending, but it helps.
Mm.
Palau does have a better winner, mm-hmm. like more defining winner of the season. Not that the, like Final Tribal was the most interesting; he was just like him versus Katie. But then Danny is just like this under the radar, like so under the radar she beat the radar that there wasn't much to watch there.
Mm.
So not the most interesting or compelling winner.
So it was almost like she was just hard to edit around. It kind of seemed like to me. It was like
so
it
she
was
claimed
like,
that she didn't want to tell him anything juicy in fears that it would get to other people, you know.
Mm. Oh, that's right. We've talked about this before, I'm sure.
Mm-hmm.
But
so that's where I'm really stuck. But I think put it a notch below Palau in C tier.
Totally fair.
We're talking
totally
about all fair. These great moments on each of these seasons, like, and these are C tier, you know. But it's an average. This average Survivor season is a great season.
Yeah, it's still very entertaining television. So,
so next up we go Survivor Panama Exile Island.
Panama,
which previously you had ranked at number 7, I had it at number 3 out of the first 15. I have very high on. Panama. The thing is, it just delivers so much. You take the biggest downside of the season is that one tribe is really boring, with Astronaut Dan and Terry and the other white guy and Sally.
Terry and the other white guy.
They all just kind of blend together. They're just
They do. They're very boring.
And then, but you go over to the other tribe, and it's the most chaos and crazy personalities you ever seen on a tribe. Kasaya, it's just beautiful to watch.
Call Jeff on the Jeff phone. Oh no, that was not that one. No, was it called Jeff on his Jeff phone?
No,
it wasn't.
Rocky wanted them to call Jeff on
Rocky.
The
Jeff. Yeah, Jeff wanted. Yeah, no, I'm thinking
Rocky
of.
Could have
I
fit in there.
Rocky
could have come into the.
Rocky could have come in and been chaotic. No, I was thinking of the Blackberry.
Yep, Shane's Blackberry.
Shane's Blackberry. He's like,
Shane's a crazy character. It's one of the most unhinged stuff. Saying I would come back and kill you in your shitty apartment.
Yeah, and she loved it. She loved it. She
I
loved.
I don't have a shitty apartment, man. My apartment's not shitty, man.
That's all she said, but then she laughed the whole time and looked like she wanted to just, like, grab his face and make out with him. Like, it was weird. There's some weird, just weird energy all around that whole tribe.
Attention.
Yeah.
But this is the birth of Ceri Fields, the
birth of Ceri, it's for sure.
She's awesome. I mean, she's instantly, like, super charming in the season and does some great strategy.
This is top of B for me.
Okay.
Up B.
We have good. The 3-2-1 vote. You got.
Yeah.
The beauty of. You got Bruce can't drop a deuce. You got.
Aris versus Terry. Please don't say. Please don't talk.
Can I sing
please
to
don't
you?
Sing. No, please don't.
No.
No. Stop. No. Stop.
Poor guy.
Oh, jeez.
I give it an A tier, my friend.
Isn't that where Shane just like wanders in naked as well? Top of A, you said?
He does come in naked at some point.
Yeah, he wanders in naked while that whole thing was going on.
Top
of A.
It's either top of A. I previously had it right below Vanuatu.
Hmm.
I'll put it right above Vanuatu now. Let's see.
It's a good season, for sure.
Next up, we've got Survivor Cook Islands, which previously you had at number 8, and I had at number 7, right around the middle. Cook Islands is one of those things where it has so many, like, spotty, like, twists that it tries, it throws at us. They're kind of rough, but it has some of the awesome. It's an awesome cast and some great moments as well. You know,
yeah it's tough because like this is one that best pilot easily, your best first episode of the season.
They split up the tribes by race.
Yeah,
which on its face is not great. In the sense that it's like, okay, well we're gonna.
It's a race war here on Survivor.
It's a race war, yeah.
Yeah.
And you literally saw them like scrambling to make sure it's not like all white people final five, like.
Yeah.
Sort of throwing whatever they can at us to make it not happen. And they didn't think that through. Like we literally saw what they should have done, which is what they did in Fiji, where it's like, okay, we just have equal representation of all the.
Yeah, the just races have an extremely diverse cast.
Because we saw immediately with a diverse cast, there was like a lot of great personalities and added a lot to the season right from the jump. You have Yul, who's a beautiful man and a beautiful mind.
Yeah. He's
Jonathan Penner is born here as well, so.
Yeah, that's bollocks and you know it.
You have the classic idol play where he brings Jonathan over, which is iconic. But then we have, of course, they have the mess of the message in a bottle, and
there's stuff that the
surprise final three and
stuff that's really easy to like in this season, but it's also just there's that much stuff holding it back at the same time. It's like it is at almost at odds with itself a lot of the time.
Mm-hmm. Seeing it as a tier list, I think I have a more confident spot of where I would put it.
Okay, where would you put it? I'm not necessarily decided yet. But.
It feels right at the top of B for me.
Okay.
Like a notch below Panama, Vanuatu, Amazon, but right above Marquesas and Borneo. Just because, like, gotta knock it a little bit for some of these, like, decisions that were not great.
Yeah.
But.
Yeah, I think I'm gonna put it in a similar place. I'm gonna put it below. I'm gonna put it middle of B. So I now have Panama, Cook Islands, Borneo. Mm. I think he does a lot of stuff really well. I think I like a lot of the chemistry. The cast is just comes alive when you have the diversity.
You chop them up like poop.
In the cast. You chop them up like poop, basically. Yeah.
Candace from Raro Tribe, that's in this.
Yeah, it's freaking Billy. Our boy, you know, he's coming in here.
Billy Garcia.
and
for what it's worth, we didn't know it at the time. We wouldn't have said it as a great highlight, but we have, this is where Parvati is first introduced.
Yeah.
And we got Ozzy's first introduced here. He comes to the final three against Yule, and it's like this strategic versus physical.
Mm.
And so some interesting stuff here.
Yeah. It's just that overly powerful idol dominated the game. Message in a bottle. And yeah, I mean, man, I might even put it a little higher. I'll leave it where it is for now. I think it's pretty good right there. I think it's solid right there.
And there's a whole mutiny too. Didn't even mention the mutiny, which is like
the mutiny, was right?
A pivotal thing. Somehow Jonathan survived ahead of so many of their tribe when he should have easily gone. And at least in that message in a bottle, you would think. But
yeah,
and then they just blow it, and it literally costs them when he flips on them.
Yeah.
But it's just Cook Islands I'm constantly referring back to. It's just like so many iconic moments and players from that season. So gotta give it some credit. So where do you settle on?
I'm in middle of B. So it's Panama, Cook Islands, Borneo in B, which is just under Amazon, Vanuatu, Outback.
Okay. I feel you. It's kind of like a sister season to Panama in the same way that Palau and Guatemala are. Mm. But I just feel like Panama's more solid for me.
Mm-hmm.
All right, next up, Survivor Fiji, which previously you had at number 12 of 15. I had at number 11 of 15.
Yeah.
Again, Fiji. Some great characters in there. Earl, Yao Man, Dreams. Awesome drama with the whole car deal. diverse cast.
Dreams in general was just like such a wacky player.
Mm-hmm.
It made a lot of chaos just ensued pretty much in his wake at every step of the way.
We had Rocky up until a point. I think we got just as much Rocky as we needed.
Yeah,
you know, he didn't overstay his welcome too much.
Yeah, because we started to turn on him a little bit right when I was like, ugh. This is gross.
Went from the start of the show, like the first episode, then it's like, oh, toxic masculinity, Rocky.
Yeah, it's like cool.
But apparently, Rocky and Anthony are like friends to this day, so it's a beautiful love story there.
Well, there you go.
Look, Anthony, you know, there is like the stuff after the season we talked about where they really left out like a whole storyline that was pretty pivotal in the pre-merge.
Yeah, how the alliance I think that's
formed.
Super lame. Super lame that happened.
But we had the first implementation of this new form of idol, which we really like, where you have to actually like have the read and play it before the votes are read. We saw the first successful idol play. We saw an unsuccessful idol play in the old Edgardo blind side where they Stacey's like, we hit him from the left when they're not expecting it. Because it was this whole, like, whisper challenge with Dreams, where Dreams took the information from them to them, and they're like, well, do we trust Dreams now? So let's just, like, not do either of the options and go for Edgardo. And it was great stuff there.
And then we won't tell Dreams anything. So it was almost like you knew not to trust Dreams, but it was funny because it was like, they were almost like, they let slip information when he was around, so then it was like, oh, okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, loose lips sink ships, that's all I have to say.
But I still think back on it fairly fondly.
Yeah, me too. I
love the card game. Maybe a little too...
We're maybe being a little too hard on it, I don't know.
I think I'll put it, for me, right in the middle of C tier. So below Palau, Guatemala, and right above Australian Outback All-Stars.
Okay. I think I've got it. I think I have it sandwiched also, but Marquesas All-Stars, Fiji, Guatemala, Palau. I think it's where I have it.
Okay. Yep. I feel that. There's enough, and we also didn't even mention one of the more glaring flaws, which was the whole twist of the haves versus the have-nots.
Oh, God, okay. That was definitely actually a legitimate complaint I had. Still have for that season. Not great.
Not ideal.
Nope.
but still, such fond memories with that season. So, yeah, C tier, can't be mad at it for me.
Yeah, personally. No, it's still solid Survivor.
So. Next up, we got Survivor China.
Cool.
I mean, it's iconic. Previously, you had it number 6. I had it number 4 out of 15.
Yeah.
There's so many moments in this season. I mean, we love Todd was a great strategic mind throughout the whole season. The Courtney, her whole element that she brought to the game, her snark and her feuding and like no filter. And then Amanda with her dopey, doughy eyes.
That
bringing that weak, sad energy that we love to see at Tribal Council.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, you love it. Love to see
Denise, allegedly a lunch lady.
Yeah. And, turns out to be fake news. Yeah. Turns out to be complete fake news. We were lied to. Producers were lied to.
Eric and Jamie, a brewing love story that turned south, unfortunately.
Oh, geez, no. Oh, no.
But it was innocent. If you look at it in a vacuum, which you could try to do for a season, it's innocent enough.
That was the key. She fell in love with a virgin, so I guess that was the problem, I guess, ultimately.
That's actually the big takeaway here.
Yeah. He was a virgin with rage. Yeah.
Jamie had the whole idol play where she played the thing that wasn't an idol. James loved it. James went out with two idols. They had all these maneuvers pre-merge where we had that twist we didn't like, where you had to get to take the two strongest members from the other tribe, and then PG's like the gamer mind of like, oh, let's just take advantage of this, throw the challenge and get them out. But then she, after the first one, she gets spooked when she tries to communicate with her other tribe members, and she's like, I'm not confident in this. So then it goes up with like a back and forth unexpectedly, because then they try to throw the challenge, but they can't because Denise can't eat the thing. A lot of kinks in the plan and whatnot.
So I just put this, this is an A for me, under Vanuatu.
Okay. It's one of those things where like I feel like it could almost be an S tier season. Yeah, it really feels for like real. It. We get a lot of...
Yeah, it does.
We just already see iconic characters, just like with Cook Islands. We got, you know, James and Amanda come into Micronesia. Mm-hmm. So there's standouts. I mean, James is like a fan favorite both seasons. We would love Todd.
Todd's like one of the best winners of the whole game.
And one of the
theming,
more
this yeah, strong theming. Theming. Strong Very theming. Strong. Perfect. They did a really good job.
We love it, all the cultural stuff in there.
Yeah.
We love when Leslie was being disrespectful early on.
Yeah, we love that. We were here for that.
It was fun little things where you could like give the clue to the person in the other tribe, and then it always found its way to Todd.
Yeah, somehow it always found its way to Todd.
One of the most interesting dynamic final tribals where like everybody got votes, and it was like actually like, ooh, what could it be?
Yeah, yeah, it was fun. Courtney robbed Amanda of some votes there.
Because previously I had Panama and Vanuatu above it. I don't know if I really stand by that now. I'm going to put it at the top of A tier for now.
Okay.
But it definitely jumped up above a couple right there.
Yeah.
So where did you have it exactly?
I think I have it... I'm actually going to put it above Vanuatu. I have it... I know, so it's, we have Pearl Islands, Amazon, China, Vanuatu, Outback. That's what I have on A tier.
Okay. That leaves us with Survivor Micronesia, fans versus favorites. Previously, we left you with a little tease if you watched the end of the season review. We kind of said where we think we're headed, and it's only up, you know, we're at the very top. Yep. Is it like, is it number one or number two is kind of where both we're at, I think.
Yeah. I think where I'm going to, I think I'm. I think I'll break the ice. This is my favorite season of Survivor so far.
Yeah.
This is number one for me.
One for me too.
It literally hit all the beats. All the beats that you could. So this is an interesting little tidbit as I flash back and forth between the tier lists here. We have the same sort of charting on our graph. Like 2S, 4A, 3B, 5C, 1D, 1F.
Whoa.
which is really interesting.
And I still don't know if I really stand by the D for Africa. It feels kind of mean. Yeah. But I just put Africa itself. But
it does feel kind of mean. It's almost like me putting, I put Marquesas in C, atop of C. I'm just like, I remember liking it. I guess.
Could almost bring All Stars down into D with it, yeah. Maybe. But
yeah.
Micronesia is excellent. I mean, it's got.
Yeah. From start to finish.
Fan favorites, obviously. Fans and favorites. Yeah. And despite like the quits and the medevacs, it made for an awesome season. With Jonathan Penner delivered so much in that pre-merge with like Jonathan Penner versus Sari. We had Chet getting dragged and not having his life valued in that game.
By truck.
Yeah. And then we had epic blindsides after blindsides. Ozzy, Jason, Eric with the ultimate best moment in Survivor history. I don't know what you want to call it. Might be
most iconic. I think it might be like right there. Like, it was,
it's such a beautiful episode. How they showed it all coming together. This perfect team pulling it off. Like everybody had their role to play.
Everyone nailed it. I love that message. Like, it's like you are, a guaranteed Final Four.
That sucks.
That's rough. And
still,
that's
shout out to right Eric there, who did make our art like way early on into our channel, like 2019.
Yeah. Yeah. Thanks. Yeah. Thanks a lot. And
we still use it for our profile picture, and we still use the Tarkron logo. He did the typography for it that I still use in a lot of stuff.
Fantastic work, and love the. Ended up being, talented artist, but also ended up being a part of one of my favorite moments in the whole show of Survivor, and I guess it makes sense that is one of the. What people like refer to as probably one of the most iconic moments of the whole show.
Definitely. So, and then you're left with like one of the most solid Final Fours, like some all great, great players and all women alliance that ran the game.
Where we both said, I think going into the finale is like any one of these could win. And it's not like, it's not a horrible disappointment. You know, it's like, it was a very solid Final Four, for sure.
The only asterisk on the season is that surprise Final Two, which did our girl dirty, but we don't let it off on that. But it's like every season you can point to something like that. Pearl Islands, which is right up with it. You see the Outcast twist, not great. Mm-hmm. Just the same with this. Unfortunate, but. Still a satisfying winner. It's not like that happened and then we got a horrible winner. Would have been a different story. But just an awesome, like, narratively, it's a great season. Like, everything worked out in such a nice way that made sense. And just a lot of iconic moments. This effing stick. Give up immunity. my ass. Love it. Great. Yeah. Great stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, since season 7, it's like, there hasn't been any question. No season has been like, is it better than Pearl Islands? It wasn't even close.
Yeah.
So it's amazing to be.
Yeah, China was like the closest thing, and that was the season before this that we both loved, and it's pretty awesome that we get a season that was even better after that, which is like, wow.
Yeah.
Pretty great.
And so I think that's it. Still torn on All Stars. You know what? I know we have perfect synchronicity, but I'm gonna bring All Stars down to the top of D.
You can do whatever you want, baby. There you go.
Top of Boom. D for me.
Top of D. Big D.
Big D Big energy.
D. Big D and energy. So I'm gonna keep mine the way it is. I think I'm pretty satisfied with this.
There are tier lists.
Mine. Zach's.
Yep.
There you have it.
I feel good about it. A lot of stuff moved around for us, but for some reason it feels more natural in a tier list. You know, rather than just having this huge list, it's a little more daunting of where to put it.
Yeah.
It's kind of easier to
we can kind of visualize it. We talked through it too. I think that helps a little bit. You know, talking through the whole thing.
A real good trip down memory lane, going through all the highlights of all these seasons. You know.
Yeah.
And
so, well, I think this is good because this is the standard definition era right here. The 480i.
That's
standard
right.
Definition broadcast. Right. Now
so
we're coming
we'll
into.
We'll be doing a separate tier list for all the HD seasons. You can't compare standard definition to HD.
I still want them to every so often to roll back to the potato cam. I want them to do that every so often.
Oh, they're going to say every other season they should go standard definition just for the old time's sake.
Just for old time's sake.
Love it.
We still got these cameras and a bunch of film lying around. Why don't we do that?
It's like, oh, weird choice, but okay.
Yeah.
It's like... But, so next up for us, we're going to do the same thing, but for winners. Mm. All right? We're going to go through all the winners and figure that out, because we've never... That could recontextualize a lot of them as well in our rankings.
Yeah.
Put them on S through F tier list. So we'll do that probably a week from now. Since this is a nice meaty video, it'll probably be a week apart. And then after that, we'll be on to the next season, to the high definition era. And we'll see you then. After that, we'll be doing videos. You can see a reaction to every episode of Survivor as we go through it. And then at the end of the season, we always do a season review, talk about everything, give out some awards to some like fan favorite players and stuff. And then we'll do a ranking where we do all the tier lists in one nice video afterwards as well.
Right.
So looking forward to that. I hope you join us every week. New Survivor videos. So much fun. A lot of great stuff. Just like I said, large majority of the seasons, I'm not going to call them bad.
Yeah.
You know, I only have three seasons that are in D and F. And even those two D ones, I'm like very torn on whether they should be down there.
Right.
Or not.
It's like Thailand is just an easy, like, yeah. We have to decide. There has to be one, and it's got to be you.
So. It's the roughest one to get through, and it would be the hardest, I think, to sell someone on Survivor to if like, you just like watch this.
Yeah,
and have them like
check this out.
Actually stick it out all the way,
which is it's fun that that's our first one that we started reactions on to.
Yep, in retrospect, would have been great to start from the beginning.
Yeah,
I had no idea if you would be into it from the first season or not.
Yeah, yeah.
So here we are. Thank you for watching.
All right.
If you enjoyed this video, go check out our ranking everything we reviewed in a tier list. So check out our most recent one we did earlier this year. So in case you don't know, we do like this tier list annually now, pretty much every January or around there. We'll rank everything we've reviewed and we'll add on to our big tier list. And that includes Survivor season, so they're in our mega tier list. Now we'll have to reevaluate that.
It's true. It's going to be funny.
Because we're probably all over the place.
Yeah. They're probably like, oh, we got Palau like in S tier.
But we also
know?
Have, that's also like a consensus thing. We don't have our own tier list, so we have to come to an agreement on those.
Right, right.
But, thank you. Check that out. And like the video if you enjoyed. Let us know your thoughts below. As always, take care of yourself.
Take care.
All right.